Hello students, good morning. In yesterday's class we completed structure of nucleus. We have seen the structure and types of chromosomes in detail. Okay, so yesterday I told you that one part is remaining from this, that is special types of chromosomes. Okay, so today first we will see what are the special types of chromosomes. Okay, these chromosomes are known as giant chromosomes because they are very huge in size as compared to the normal chromosomes. Okay, and then we will complete the last type of cell organelle which is remaining, that is microbodies. Fine. So let's see what are the special types of chromosomes. Okay, so give heading special types of chromosomes. Fine. First I will explain both the types. Okay, and then I will write down some important points related to this. Now why they are called as special chromosomes? Because they are not found in all types of cells. Okay, they are present at a certain stages of development in some cells. Okay, and they are very huge, you can say 1000 times larger than our normal types of chromosomes. Fine. There are two types of special chromosomes. From that first one, it is known as lamp brush chromosome. Okay, the first one, it is known as lamp brush chromosome. Okay, and the second one, it is known as polytene chromosomes. Okay, so lamp brush chromosomes and polytene chromosome, very interesting things are this, so just try to understand. Now let's see what is mean by lamp brush chromosome. Lamp brush, the name which is given to this type of chromosome, because these chromosomes, they look like a brush which we use to clear our bottles or lamps. Okay, that normal brush we have at home, with the help of that we clean our plastic bottles or lamp. So as this chromosome, they look like a lamp brush, these chromosomes are known as lamp brush chromosomes. Fine. These chromosomes were first seen by Fleming. So we will write down some things, some important points for this. These are highly elongated. These are highly elongated special type of chromosome and are occur in pairs. Okay, so these chromosomes are present in pair. Okay, occur in pairs. Okay, now these chromosomes were first seen by Fleming. Okay, so first seen by Fleming in 1882, but were first described by Rucket in 1892. First described by Rucket in 1892. Fine. Now where are these types of chromosomes are found? These types of chromosomes are found usually in oocytes of vertebrate, or in case of the animal, oocyte. Oocyte means what? If you have learned process of reproduction in class 10th, in case of oogenesis, that is a process of formation of egg or ovum in animals. So there is a oogonium which give rise to ovum. So in the developmental stage, that oogonium develops into primary oocyte. Primary oocyte undergoes meiotic division to produce eggs or ovum. So these type of chromosomes are naturally found, or they are most common in oocyte of animals. Fine. Along with this, they are also present in your synergids or endosperms or the antipodal cells of embryo sac. Fine. So found in animal oocytes At this stage, or we can study this chromosome when the cell is at diploting stage. Okay, next year when we will study the human reproduction, that time you will understand what is the significance of this. So diploting, it is one of the sub phase of prophase. Mitosis or meiosis has four phases: prophase, metaphase, anaphase and telophase. Details we are going to study in the next week when we will start the next lesson, cell division. So right now you just try to understand. When you will understand those things, automatically these things will be clear. So in this case, we can observe this chromosome when they say it as diploting stage. Diploting stage, it is one of the phase of prophase. Fine. So found in animal oocyte, I will mention in bracket, at diploting stage. Okay. So at this stage, we can find this Lambrecht chromosome. Okay. Along with this, they are also present in, okay, some other things also. Fine. So they are present in the animal oocyte, first of all reported in this, okay, animal oocyte of most of the animals, and their size, okay, or length may be up to 5900 micrometer. Okay. Their length, they are very huge in size, they are very long. Their length may go up to 5900 micrometer. These chromosomes occur in pair and they are attached to each other at a point that is known as chiasmata. Fine. So they occur in pair and attached at special points, attached at special points called chiasmata. Okay, it is called as chiasmata. So these homologous pair, yesterday we have seen what is mean by homologous chromosome. Okay, chromosomes belonging to same pair, they are called as homologous chromosome. Homo meaning similar. In a pair, when it consists of two chromosomes, so those two chromosomes are said to be homologous chromosome. Fine. So these homologous chromosome may remain attached at certain points. So these points are known as chiasmata. Fine. I hope you all have understood. Now let's see what is its structure. Now here what happened, it consists of a main axis, and that main axis, it has so many lateral extended loops, and these loops give the appearance of brush. Okay, I will draw the diagram. From that you can understand how it looks like a brush. Okay, so lamp brush chromosome, because of presence of extensions, okay, of these chromosomes, they look like a lamp brush. Fine. Now suppose this is the chromosome axis. First I will draw the entire chromosome and then I will enlarge a small part of that. As I told you, both these chromosomes, they occur in pair, and they are attached at certain points. These points are known as chiasmata. Suppose this is the point where these two chromosomes, they are attached to each other. This is the main axis of chromosome. From the main axis, we can find such extended loops. Okay. These loops are nothing but the extended portion of chromosome. Okay, I will enlarge one smart part of, or the one small part of this. But because of this extension, because of this loop, okay, these chromosomes, they appear or they take shape of lamp brush. Okay, so we call it them as lamp brush chromosomes. Fine. I'm drawing it completely so that you can understand its structure. Yes. Now these are the expand. Now what is the significance of this type of chromosomes? This type of chromosomes, whenever they present, they increase the protein synthesis. Both the types, okay, that is your Lambrush chromosome as well as polytin chromosome. Okay, their significance is that because of their structure, they can produce large number of proteins. As you know that oocyte, okay, it is a cell which is going to form egg in future. Okay, so egg should receive most amount of nutrition. So that process is known as vitellogenesis, yolk synthesis. Okay, so because of this, large numbers of proteins are synthesized so that egg cell can store those proteins. So in the synthesis of yolk, okay, so in case of the oocyte, when the cell require large amount of proteins, this type of chromosomes help. Okay, so they are present in almost all type of animal oocyte. Fine. Then next one. Now this is, or this chromosome, they look like this. Okay, so it is known as Lambrush chromosome. We will just label these parts. Okay, the main axis. This is the main axis. Okay, these are loops. Okay, these loops may range, okay, or they have a huge number. Their length may about 5 to 100 micrometer in length. Okay, their number could vary from chromosome to chromosome, but their length is about 5 to 100 micrometer. Surrounding to loop, there is aggregation of mRNA and protein, so that forms the matrix. Okay, so these loops are surrounded by matrix. Okay, this matrix consists of rRNA, nascent rRNA, it consists of mRNA. Okay, mRNA as well as rRNA. So nascent RNA, I'll write only RNA, RNA and proteins. Okay, consist of RNA and proteins. So there is a main axis, then this loop, there is a matrix. Fine. Now let's see the enlarged view of one part of this. Suppose we will enlarge this much portion. Okay, and let's see how it looks. Fine. Now this is the axis. Okay, its extended loop that continues. Fine. Here it further extends. Okay, and now these are the pairs. Fine. So this paired structure, now outside there is a matrix. Okay, so these paired structures are known as chromomeres. Okay, so here there is a matrix surrounding to each loop. Okay, surrounding to each loop you will find there is a matrix which consists of RNA and proteins, consisting of RNA and protein. Okay, so I will draw this and then I will give the labels so that you can understand it. Fine. So this is the chromosome. Okay, these two paired structure, these are known as chromomere. Chromomere pair. Yesterday I have told you, when we discuss the structure of nucleus, heterochromatin, at certain places, heterochromatin or the DNA, it is highly coiled, it is more condensed. Those structures are known as chromomeres. Okay, so at joint, these chromomeres, they occur in pair, and then this DNA extends further. So this is the loop. Okay, and this is matrix. Okay. So this is the loop and matrix. Fine. So this is the structure of lamp brush chromosome. Now what is the significance of this? See, obviously, what is this? These loops are nothing but these are the separated fragments of DNA, okay, which are going to undergo transcription. Fine. So as protein synthesis, it is required at the time of vitellogenesis or yolk formation, the rate of transcription, rate of protein synthesis has to be increased. For that, DNA, okay, gets separated, okay, and at a time we can say the protein synthesis, it is enhanced. So these extended loops, these are nothing but separated fragments of DNA, okay, from these chromosomes, okay. So whenever we see loops over here, means at a time, at these many places, protein synthesis or the process of transcription is going on. Fine. So this is about the lamp brush chromosome. So loops are the uncoiled parts, okay. I will mention here loops, these are uncoiled parts of chromomere, uncoiled parts of chromomere with one to many transcriptional units, with one to many transcriptional unit. Okay, these loops are for rapid transcription. Loops are for rapid transcription, okay, to produce mRNA, okay, and this is meant for yolk synthesis, okay, as well as other substances which are required for growth, for yolk synthesis and other substances required for growth and development. Okay. So other substances required for growth and development. Fine. So these are the uncoiled parts of chromosome with one to many transcriptional unit. Okay. They are involved in the rapid transcription of mRNA, okay, which are meant for the yolk synthesis as well as synthesis of required or the substances for growth. Fine. So these types of chromosomes are called as polyteam chromosomes. Okay. Now let's see the next. These type of chromosomes are known as lamp brush chromosome. Okay. Now let's study the second type of chromosome, that is polyteam chromosomes. Again, these are giant chromosomes, huge chromosomes. Okay. But smaller than lamp brush chromosome. Lamp brush chromosomes are much more larger than these polyteam chromosomes. Fine. Now these polyteam chromosomes are also, okay, or why the name it is given to this polyteam chromosome, because they have so many arms or so many chromosomes, they are attached to each other. So it looks like one centromere consists of so many arms. Poly means many. Antenna means threads. Okay, so it looks like that at one centriole so many thread-like structures are attached. So it is known as polyteam chromosome. Fine. These polyteam chromosomes were first reported by Balbini. Okay, I'll cut this lamp brush chromosome now. Polyteam chromosome first reported by Balbini. In 1881, in salivary glands of insects, okay, in salivary glands of insects, okay. So these chromosomes are also called as salivary chromosomes, okay, as they are found in this salivary gland of insects. These chromosomes are also called as salivary chromosomes. Okay, so also called as salivary chromosomes. Okay, they are also found in the antipodal cell and endosperm cells of a plant. Okay, embryo sac, you might have studied the structure of embryo sac. Also found in antipodal cell, also found in antipodal cell and endosperm cell, antipodal and endosperm cell of embryo sac, antipodal as well as endosperm cell of embryo sac. Fine. Now they are also very huge in size. Their length may range up to 2000 micrometer. Length may range up to 2000 micrometer. Okay. They are multi-stranded. They are multi-stranded. Okay. I will draw the diagram later on. Okay. They are multi-stranded and formed by somatic pairing between chromosomes. Okay. Formed by somatic pairing between homologous chromosomes, and repeated division of chromonemata. I will explain this point. These are formed by somatic pairing of homologous chromosomes. Obviously, so there is a somatic pairing, there is a pairing of homologous chromosomes, okay, as well as repeated divisions of chromonemata. So obviously it will increase in the size. This chromonemata will repeat so many times that will result into increase in the length of chromosomes. Fine. At certain stages, now here what happened, all these chromosomes may remain attached to the one centromere or one point that is known as chromocenter. All chromosomes remain attached at a common point, which is called chromocenter. I will draw the diagram now, which is called as chromocenter. So as there is a homologous pairing, these chromosomes, they remain attached at a common point. So only it looks like that in one chromosome there are so many arms. Usually each chromosome has only one upper arm and one lower arm. Okay. But here there is a homologous pairing, so it looks like that one chromosome, it has so many arms. So it is known as polyteen chromosome. Fine. I will draw the diagram. Okay. Now, so that you will understand. Then in this chromosome, one important point is that at certain places DNA uncoils, okay, and it result in the formation of puff. Okay, so these puffs, these are sites of active protein synthesis, right? So when we observe these chromosomes under microscope, this looks like this. There is a common point. This is known as chromocenter. Okay. And so many chromatids are attached to it. Okay. So it has so many arms. Fine. So it looks like a multi-stranded structure like this. And when you observe externally, you can find some striations on it. So when you observe, you may find some banding on it. So these are the bands. These are nothing but these chromomeres. They are arranged parallelly. Okay. So their arrangement give rise the banded pattern. So if we enlarge this view, it looks like this. At certain places, this chromomere, okay, as these chromosomes, they are parallelly arranged. Okay. So such arrangement of chromomere, it give rise to a striated pattern. Fine. So this striated pattern, or these striations, or these bands, are because of the arrangement of chromomeres. Fine. Now, at a certain stage of development, okay, this DNA, it uncoils and it looks like a puff. Fine. So these are the sites of active protein synthesis. So these puffs, they are also called as Balbini rings. Okay. So if we enlarge its one view or one part, okay, we will find the a puff-like structure which is formed, that is the active site of DNA transcription. So DNA uncoil at this place. Okay. So this is the uncoiled DNA. Okay. Active site of transcription, or the active transcription occurs here. Okay. So such puff-like structure, it is formed, it is also known as Balbini ring. Okay. So this is the puff, okay, or Balbini ring. Okay. These puffs are nothing but these are the larger swellings. Puffs are larger swellings. Okay. Here DNA strands uncoil, become active. DNA strands uncoil, okay, it become active and produce number of copies of mRNA okay. So there are dark bands. These are dark bands, okay, and the white patch or the transparent band between these two dark band, that is known as interband. Fine. Now these are the chromomeres. Chromomeres, and this is chromonemata. Okay. Chromomeres and chromonemata. Fine. So these are these polytin chromosome, again to increase the rate of protein synthesis. Fine. So these two are the special types of chromosomes. Rarely questions will come on this part. Fine. But you should know, because these two are important points. Fine. So these are the special types of chromosome, Lambrusch chromosomes and polytin chromosomes. Fine. I hope you have understood both the times. So now let's see the last part of this lesson. Okay. Or the last cell organelles which are remaining, that is microbodies. Okay. Last cell organelles, that is microbodies. Okay. So there are three types of microbodies. Okay. Microbodies. Okay. These microbodies, they are single membrane bound, just like your vacuoles or the lysosomes. Okay. These are also tiny oval shaped structures. Okay. This some are present in animal cells, some are present in plant cells. So there are three types of microbodies. They are small in size, so that the name it is given microbodies. They are covered by a single membrane. Okay, so these are single membrane bound and are filled with different enzymes, okay, which catalyze several metabolic reactions. Okay, so microbodies are single membrane bound. These are single membrane bound, okay, and are filled with enzymes, okay, filled with enzymes, okay. These enzymes, they mediate, okay, or they offer several types of metabolic reaction, okay. Now let's see which are these microbodies. So let's see first one. These are peroxisomes, okay. The first type of microbody that is known as peroxisome, okay. They are also known as uricosome, okay. Peroxisome or uricosome, right. You might have heard or you might have studied this type also in your previous standard. But as a cell organelle, we will study this type again. Now, let's see what is the function of these peroxisomes. Fine. These peroxisomes are found in both plants as well as in animal cell. And they are involved in utilization, that is synthesis as well as breakdown of your peroxides. Okay. So, synthesis of peroxide as well as degradation or breakdown of the peroxide. So these type of cell organelles are present in both animals as well as plant cell. They were first discovered or studied by Dadaway. Okay, first reported by Dadaway. Okay, present in both plants and animal cells, they have enzymes for, okay, metabolism of peroxidase, okay, have enzymes for peroxide biosynthesis, as I told you, for synthesis as well as for degradation of these peroxides. So for peroxide biosynthesis, the enzyme which is used in the biosynthesis of peroxide, that is peroxide oxidase. Okay, so it consists of enzyme peroxide oxidase, which is involved in biosynthesis of peroxidase. Okay, it has enzymes for breakdown of hydrogen peroxide into peroxidase. Okay, also have enzymes for breakdown of hydrogen peroxide, okay, by, and that is enzyme catalase, it breaks down hydrogen peroxide into, okay, it break down, so enzyme catalase, so enzymes for synthesis of peroxide as well as for the breakdown. Along with this, they also have enzymes for beta oxidation, okay, enzymes for beta oxidation, okay. They perform function of photorespiration. In case of plant cell, they perform function of photorespiration. So in plants, okay, usually found in photosynthetic cells. In photosynthetic cell, their number, it is 70 to 100 per cells, okay, about 70 to 100 per cell, fine. In these cells, these cell organelles are involved in the process of photorespiration, okay, performs photo respiration. Okay, in association with chloroplast and mitochondria. In association with chloroplast and mitochondria. Fine. So these cell organelles are present in the chloroplast as well as mitochondria. Okay. Along with this means all these three cell organelles, that is chloroplast, mitochondria as well as these peroxisome, they commonly involved in the process of photorespiration. Photorespiration you are going to study in detail in case of your photosynthesis lesson. Photorespiration, it is a type of respiration which occur during photosynthesis. So it is known as photorespiration. Fine. So perform, they are involved in the process of photorespiration. Okay. In association with chloroplast and mitochondria. They are also involved, or they have enzymes for beta oxidation of fats. Okay. They have enzymes for beta oxidation of fatty acids. Now beta oxidation, it is a metabolic pathway or breakdown of oils or fats. So that is known as beta oxidation. Yes, in a respiration lesson we will see this part in detail. So enzymes required for beta oxidation of fatty acid are also present in this peroxisome. Okay, so these are simple sac-like structure having a single membrane filled with hydrolytic enzymes. Okay, or filled with enzymes which are responsible, which are involved in the different types of metabolic reactions. Fine. Then second type of microbody, that is known as spirosome or oleosomes. Fine. Second type of microbody, that is spirosome or oleosomes. Okay. Second microbody, spirosomes or oleosomes. Yes. These types, or they are found only in the oil storing seeds, okay, in the endosperm of those seeds which are rich in oil, like your castor, coconut. Fine. So their function is the storage and synthesis of fats. They were first reported by Parner. Okay. Their function is synthesis and storage of fats. Okay. Synthesis and storage of fats. Okay. They are abundant in the endosperm of oil seeds. Okay. Abundant in endosperm of oil seeds. Okay, they are filled with hydrolytic enzymes, so that they are thought to be lysosomes of plant cells. Okay, you know, in case of plant cells, lysosomes are absent. Fine. So these spirosomes, they are filled with hydrolytic enzymes, so they are thought to be similar like lysosomes of animal cells. Okay. Filled with hydrolytic enzymes, so they are like or act as lysosomes of plant cells. Fine. And they are produced by smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Fine. This is the second microbody, spirosome or oleosome. Then the third one, the last one, that is glyoxysomes. Third type of microbodies, that is glyoxysomes. Okay. They were first reported by Talbert and beaver. Okay. Now they have enzymes which are required for glyoxylate cycle. Now glyoxylate cycle, it is a cycle or the metabolic reactions in which fats are converted into glucose. Fine. So enzymes present only in plant cells, present only in plants, okay, that is in oily seeds. Okay, like castor, endosperms, they have enzymes for, glyoxylate cycle, okay. In glyoxylate cycle, fats are broken down into carbohydrate, okay. So, where fats are broken down into carbohydrate, okay. This process of formation of carbohydrates for fats, it is known as gluconeogenesis. So, this process is known as gluconeogenesis. Fine. So usually these metabolic reactions are occur at the time of germination in fatty cells. Okay. So during germination of fatty cells. Okay. During germination of fatty cells. Okay, all these things we will revise when we see the respiration, because all these three organelles, they are involved in photosynthesis as well as respiration. So when we will study those topic, that time this reference will come. So in case of respiration, in case of oil seeds, as they have oil as a reserve food material, fats as a reserve food material, so those fats and oils, they are broken down into carbohydrate, and then these carbohydrate, they follow the normal pathway of respiration. So reaction or enzymes which are required for breaking down of fats into carbohydrate, this process is known as gluconeogenesis. So all these enzymes required for gluconeogenesis, they are present in glyoxysome. Fine. So these are three types, okay, of microbodies. Fine. I hope you all have understood this. Now this was the last point of this lesson. Okay, we took so many days to complete this lesson because this lesson is very important. Okay, I wanted you to study each and every cell organelle in detail. Okay, now along with this lecture, I'm sending some questions also. Okay, these are very good question. In tomorrow's class, what we will do, I will discuss some questions. Okay, what type of questions are important for exam, I will discuss some previous year's questions also. I will give you some additional points, okay, on that question, may or may not come, means just like general things related to this topic. So today you have to revise this lesson. I'm giving you one day, you have to revise this lesson. Okay, you have to solve this question by today itself, and till night you have to send me your doubts. Doubts, not the question, just send me the point, which point you have not understood. So in next lecture I will explain that point along with some points which I have, some additional things which I found in some type of questions. So those questions also I will discuss with you. I will provide those questions to you also, so that while listening that lecture, you could also see those questions. Fine. But I want everyone to solve these questions which I am sending. Okay, after this lecture you have to solve these questions, because number of questions are there. Some questions are based on some common thing, general knowledge. Sometimes it is not required that each and every part should be mentioned in your notes. You have to use some logic also. Okay, so for that, some typical questions are there, for that you need to use your logic. Some different types of questions also I have with me, so I will also discuss those questions tomorrow. But before that, you have to revise this lesson go through the notes, go through NCERT properly. Actually, I wanted to do the NCERT reading. If possible, I will make one video. In that, I will tell you how to read the NCERT. Because for these lessons, I will tell you wherever it is required. For these lessons, MCQs come from NCERT line to line. But for understanding, it is very important to explain you in a depth. Fine. So each and every line, each and every diagram for this lesson as well as next lesson, it is very important. Question can frame on any statement, any word from NCERT. So if possible, I will try to make. Otherwise, in tomorrow's class, I will discuss some important questions or important point. But before that, by today evening, okay, I should get your doubts, okay, then only I can make a next lecture or the next video on that, fine. So this is for the day. Now we will meet in the next class, okay. So I hope you all will send your questions, okay. Goodbye and take care.